My friends in Christ, grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. This morning we continue our summer series on questions that you were afraid to ask about the faith, but that your kids weren't. And our focus today is on faith and on belief. And what exactly does it mean when we're talking about those things? And how does that shape us? And how does that play out in our lives? And I was thinking about this, if someone was talking to me, and they said to me, "Matt, I believe in you," or "Matt, I have faith in you," what is it exactly that they're telling me? Are they telling me, "Matt, I believe you exist. I believe your name is Matt. I believe that you have brown hair and green eyes and that you're 38 years old and that you're married and you have two kids and work for a church. I have faith in the fact that you have a goofy sense of humor, you have a weakness for bad puns, and you have a strange fascination with bacon." Or are they saying, "Matt, I trust you. I trust you. I know you, and we have a relationship, and you have demonstrated that you are not going to let me or yourself down." When we're talking to each other, and we say, "I believe in you, and I have faith in you," what we're really saying to each other is that second set of statements. But many times, when we as Christians refer to faith or to belief in God, it ends up being more like the first set. We say we believe in God when what we really mean is that we believe things about God. Now, don't get me wrong. It's important to believe things about God and to learn and to grow through what those things are. I mean, that's what the creeds are about. That's what Bible study helps do for us. That's why we learn about Scripture, why we watch for God at work in the world and in the people around us. Now, the things that we believe about God help shape and help us understand how we see our relationship with God and how we see our relationships with each other and how we see God's relationship with the world. Now, take three imaginary people. Now, one person believes that God created the universe and set it into motion and has just sort of let things go from there, like a watchmaker who builds a watch and winds it up and lets it go. One believes that God is like an angry judge, you know, looking down on the world's sin with fury and warning people that they better straighten up and fly right or else to face divine wrath and punishment. And one person believes that God is infinitely loving and that in God's eyes, what is considered sinful for you might not be considered sinful for me, but that's okay because there aren't such things as right and wrong. Only different. Now, I could come up with a bunch more frameworks for ways that different people have believed about God, but you get the idea. Now, this is the same God that I'm describing, but those three people, based on what they believe about God, are going to have very, very different experiences in their lives and the way that God impacts their lives. And for the first person, if God really is completely absent from worldly affairs, then if anything at all is ever going to get done, it's going to be completely up to us. And God is not present. God is not with us in the midst of whatever it is we might be facing. But for the second person, life is filled with fear and anger, fear for their own soul, fear for the souls of the people around them, anger at themselves for when they mess up, anger at the world for their own sin. And for this third person, everything is relative. When things happen, there's no truth to cling to, and ultimately no need for the cross. And so that is why Jesus spent so much time describing what the reign of God looks like and why he used stories to do so. He knew that what one believes about God and about the way God works is indeed important, and it helps shape our faith. And he also knew that what he was trying to describe was ultimately beyond description. Like, how do you describe God's eternal reign? How do you describe God? And so Jesus used stories. He used parables. And so he compares God to a widow who tears her house apart until she finds that lost coin that she's been looking for. Or he compares God to a shepherd who leaves the rest of the herd to go searching for the lost one. Or he compares God to a grieving father who sees his lost son coming home and promptly forgets all decorum and runs out to meet him, robes flapping in the breeze, and then he throws a giant party. He compares God's reign to a mustard seed, which is small and insignificant, and yet it sprouts, and it grows into a large tree. He used many, many other stories like this, none of which can completely describe God or completely describe the reign of God, but each of which gives us glimpses into what we believe about God. It allowed Jesus to say, God's kind of like this, and he's also kind of like this, and God's also kind of like this. And so the things that we believe about God are indeed important, but that is not the full story. That is not fully what faith and what belief is. Belief about God, when we get down to it, really is head knowledge. But belief in God, trust in God, is heart knowledge. And Martin Luther understood this. In his large catechism, he wrote in his explanation of the first commandment, the first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. He wrote about this, and he realized that that first commandment was about more than just making sure we don't say, oh, I believe some other God exists. And this is what he wrote in his explanation. He writes, a God is the term for that to which we are to look for all good, and in which we are to find refuge in all need. Therefore, to have a God is nothing else than to trust and believe in that one with your whole heart. As I've often said, it is the trust and faith of the heart alone that make both God and an idol. If your faith and trust are right, then your God is the true one. Conversely, where your trust is false and wrong, there you do not have the true God, for these two belong together, faith and God. Anything on which your heart relies and depends, I say that is really your God. Faith in God, belief in God, is trust in God. It is for our hearts to rely and to depend on God. It is to look to God for all good and to find refuge in all of our need. When faith ends up being reduced to just needing to agree to a group of statements about God, we cheapen faith. We remove that relationship. We turn away from our dependence on God. To have faith in God means that in the good and in the bad, in the joys and in the sorrows, in our doubts, in our questions, in our deep, dark nights of the soul, as well as the heights of our mountaintop experiences, we have the assurance that God is present, that God will never leave us, and that God walks beside us. We know that we can trust God. That was the big question with the disciples in the boat with Jesus. They were crossing the lake and the storms came up, and what was their question to Jesus? Their question was, do you not care that we are perishing? Their issue wasn't what they believed about Jesus. It wasn't that they didn't think he could do anything about their situation. They knew he could do something. Their question to him was, don't you care? Are you going to leave us alone? Don't you care that we might die? It was a question of trust. Do you even care, Jesus? Are you just going to leave us to fend for ourselves? Can we trust you in the storm? But when we sin, when we screw things up so badly that nobody could possibly forgive us, but when we hurt others, when we wound them physically or verbally or emotionally or spiritually, faith means that in the storm, we can trust that nothing will separate us from the love of God in Jesus. When others sin against us, when some sick person shoots up a movie theater or attacks a woman in her apartment, and all that we can do is wonder what is wrong with the world, faith means that in the storm, we can trust that nothing will separate us from the love of God in Jesus. When we or a loved one receives a health diagnosis that will change our life, or that may result in the end of life, faith means in the storm, we can trust that nothing will separate us from the love of God in Jesus. The opposite of faith isn't doubt. The doubts come. Questions come. We wonder if what we believe about God is right, if it's true. Now, the opposite of faith isn't necessarily even fear. When bad things happen, when the storms come, we are going to be afraid. Anyone who has lived for any length of time has known fear, and that doesn't go away, no matter how strong our faith in God may be. And you know what they say about courage? It's not the absence of fear, but that true courage is being afraid, but going ahead and doing what needs to be done anyway. Faith in God is the same thing. It may mean having doubts. It may mean having fears. But it does mean not being ruled by those doubts and fears, not living in those doubts and those fears, but living in the trust that God is with us and that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus. It means that in the storm, we trust God anyway. And that's when faith becomes real. When it can speak to our everyday lives, when it's relevant and tangible and affects our entire orientation to the world. When our heart relies and depends on God, as Luther says, then money is not our God. Time is not our God. Comfort is not our God. Doubt is not our God. Fear is not our God. All the things around us, the things that we try to put our trust in but ultimately let us down, no longer become gods to themselves, but then they return to their original intended created purpose as ways that we can love and serve God and love and serve one another. Faith in God, trust in God, belief in God leads us to lives of stewardship. A faith in God isn't just whistling past the graveyard either. It's not false optimism that if we just pray, or if we just believe hard enough, or because we're Christians, that things are going to turn out okay and we'll be happy. Because sometimes things don't turn out okay. We live in a world where stupid, evil, horrible things sometimes happen, where innocent people can suffer, where things are not always sunshine and rainbows. And this is why even when belief about God without belief in God is incomplete, the opposite is also true, that belief in God without belief about God is also incomplete. We need a foundation for our faith. We need a rock to cling to that won't wash away when the storms come. What is our foundation for for trusting God. It is the cross. The most important thing that we believe about God is that Jesus was crucified, that on the cross he met the power of sin, the power of death, head on. On the cross, he fully entered into the same injustice, into the same worldly evils that we ourselves encounter, and then 3 days later, he defeated the powers of sin, he defeated the power of death, and now he holds all of history in his nail-scarred hands. And because we believe this about God, we can have faith in God. We can trust in God's goodness. We can trust that even in suffering and in death, God has not left us alone, and that in the end, God's power, the power of humility and of love and of life, will overcome the world's power of arrogance and fear and death. Through faith in God, we have the assurance that despite the world's insistence to the contrary, goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death. And in the midst of our doubts, in the midst of our fears, we can proclaim right in those, together with all the saints who have gone before us and with all those who will come after us, that victory is indeed ours through God who loves us. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and guard your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.